You are watching a close-up look at animal welfare issues with your host, writer, speaker, and advocate, Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. This show is supported in part by AnimalWelfareIssues.com, spotlighting issues around the globe. Check out the latest TV shows, articles, podcasts, and more. That's AnimalWelfareIssues.com. Now here's your host, Tina, in 3, 2, 1.
Welcome to tonight's show. I'm Tina Evangelista-Eppenstein. We're going to get right to tonight's topic, which is hot topics. What's hot in the news right now regarding animals? I want to get straight to my guest. Directly to the right of me is Pam Bair, and she is a foster mom for Tri-State Bassett Hound Rescue, a longtime animal advocate. Next to her, we have our favorite humane officer for Hillside SPCA, Janine Choplick. And next to her, we have Mary Kay Loder. She's also a longtime animal advocate and the former president of the Animal Rescue League's Auxiliary Board, correct?
Voluntary Auxiliary.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, we're all like longtime animal advocates and we're all opinionated here, and I always love these shows. I just want to get to the very top news that I heard right before I got here, and that's about John Stewart and his wife Tracy Stewart, who have a rescue in New Jersey. And they have adopted, and this has been in the news, they've adopted a horse named Lily. If you can show that horse, Lily was shot with paintballs, she was malnourished, and she was abandoned. And some man used her as basically target practice, and she sustained some serious injuries. And I believe she lost an eye. Mm-hmm. Well, on tonight's news, they said John and his wife are picking her up. And they're also picking up another horse who's also blind in another eye. So I just want to congratulate them for what they're doing, starting this new rescue in New Jersey. And one day I hope to have them on my show as well. But I want to congratulate them for saving Lily's life. And that was really horrible because that was in Lancaster County, Lancaster
New
County SPCA.
You know, at the New Holland.
Yeah, the New Holland auction. Was it New Holland auction?
Yeah.
Right, yeah, that's where they...
They were dumping her.
Right. Well, and she was abandoned. No one knew who she belonged
right.
to. Then they discovered it. So Lily, who had this life of misery and was abused, now is on her way to a brand new home along with another horse that they saved. So that's the first news. Memorial Day, very quickly, fireworks. Janine, do you see a lot of animals with the fireworks coming up for Memorial Day?
Absolutely. Strays galore. Trace galore. Always keep ID on your pets. If they do happen to get out, we can just make that phone call and get your dog back home again.
You need to keep them inside. I mean, this really scares dogs. And keep them inside. Why do you have them outside? And keep them protected.
It's only a few hours. They can wait to go potty.
Yeah.
Until they're done.
I don't get it. But shelters really see an influx of phone calls and animals because they run. They're freaked out from them. So I want to start also with a four-month-old Boston Terrier puppy. And it's a picture with the woman holding the puppy, if you can show that. And this happened in Washington, D.C. This little puppy belongs to Michael and Mary Steele. So this four-month-old Boston Terrier puppy wasn't feeling well. So Michael, the father, decided to take Maggie out. So took her in his car. And he parked somewhere and they went for a walk. And so he took her back, put her into the car in her carrier because she's so little, left her there in DC, did errands for about 40 to 45 minutes, came back, the window was smashed, and Lily and the carrier were gone. Now, this Michael Steele, he's like a communications director, I believe, for John Boehner, the former House Speaker. So they put out a huge reward, $10,000 reward. They're putting out flyers. It made the news. So someone called and said, they have the puppy, all right? And they said, and it was a teenager, that she found the puppy outside of a school, still in its carrier, and she took the puppy home with her. And then she called, once she heard it on the news, they gave her the check for $10,000, okay? And she said that $10,000, you know, she's going to have a great prom, you know. There's a couple things wrong with this. Who leaves their four-month-old puppy in
great.
in
an
a
idiot.
City. There you go. The always opinionated Pam.
An idiot.
Inside a car for 40 minutes while you're doing errands. You can't keep an eye on your
puppy. Would you leave your baby? Well, probably.
And they bought this dog. I mean, I am glad that they're reunited. Don't get me wrong. I mean, the wife, I mean, she was in tears. They showed their reunion on television. And I think the teenager and her mom, you know, were there as well. But they bought the puppy at a pet store. They couldn't resist it. Okay, I mean, and this is what I want to get across. No matter how much any animal advocate goes out there and tries to educate the public about don't buy puppies from pet stores and the reason, or over the internet, because these puppies come from puppy mills. Make no mistake. They do not come from a nice breeder in Missouri. Okay, there is no such thing. They come from a puppy mill. And these are highly educated people, but we're not reaching the people.
You go in the mall and the puppy is so cute, and I'm saving it.
No.
I'm saving its life.
See, the whole problem is
they saw him, couldn't resist it.
Yeah.
That is the premise of a lot of people. They think they're saving the dog by adopting it from out at the Berkshire Mall. Okay.
Or from
we're
going to
saving
the Amish
this
farm.
Puppy.
Oh, they say they
no,
adopted
they're not from, saving yeah. that puppy. If they let that puppy go, yes, it may end up someplace else. It's going to end up in another state. But you're keeping the puppy mills going. The only way to put the puppy mills out of business is nobody
stop.
Buy them. And Pennsylvania, it's Chester, Lancaster, Berks. Where else is big for
Lancaster?
Lancaster, right.
Lancaster's probably the worst.
And Chester is terrible.
Is it?
Oh, yeah. There's a big sign coming into Pennsylvania that one of the people put up about Pennsylvania shame, and it's a big picture of a puppy mill.
Is this a billboard? Or just
yeah, it's a billboard.
Good.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it is.
It's a horrible thing.
Shame.
And people, the education is there. The law was there. They got around the law by going with the livestock thing. They went to the agricultural people, the ag people, instead of dogs and cats and pets. These animals are not dogs and cats to them. They are agricultural animals. They are there to be made money off of.
I think they're agricultural crops to them. Mm-hmm. I mean, they don't even see them as animals. It's like,
now, there know, are a lot them. Of very good people raising dogs. But always make sure, call your kennel club if you want to adopt a puppy. Find out who the really good breeders are. Am I right? Mm-hmm. Because there are good breeders. If I want a German Shepherd, if I want a German Shepherd, I can go over to the Animal Rescue League or the Humane Society or Hillside and I can adopt one.
That's what I think everybody should do.
They
oh my
should.
God, there's so many animals available. Janine, I mean, we all know it. We've all been around it.
But if I wanted a puppy and I want a specific puppy.
Breed.
A specific breed and I want to know, I can go and get one from a very responsible breeder. I'm not going to go to a puppy mill because these dogs, these female dogs are kept there horrible. Their conditions, they're kept in.
And our law in Pennsylvania that changed 2008 has been watered down that we're back. I mean, the female dogs, they're living on wire floors anyway. Nothing much has changed for them. There have been some changes, and the ones everyone said, you know, they've left the business, they have not.
No, they haven't.
75% of the mills are still in business.
They just hide. We took in two little Boston Terriers that were no longer any good for breeding, and I don't know how they ended up over at the league, but we brought them home. Harry asked if we'd take them, and yes, we did. We loved them. Peanut butter and jellyfish. Anyway, Peanut Butter, on her paws, had the imprints of the wire from her cage. And she never understood. She thought grass was the best thing in the world, and she wouldn't poop on that for anything in the world.
They don't see outside. They don't. Well, some live outside in kennels. They don't feel grass. And Maggie is actually, she's had parasites. She's got kennel cough, and she's still sick.
This little dog that was stolen.
Yes. And that's because she comes from a puppy mill. So, I mean, the lessons to be learned, don't leave your dog or pet, whatever,
inside
a car.
In your automobile.
Or 40 minutes. I mean, come on. I mean, and the warm. I mean, the weather was warm.
Okay.
Yes, just, I think just this past weekend, I believe. Or
okay.
The end of last week. It,
it
just
wasn't
happened.
Terribly hot. I fostered,
but,
still,
no, but
you
it
don't
doesn't
leave
matter.
Your puppy
I
in
fostered
the car.
Cats for a long time. And they went everywhere with me because they had to eat. The kittens had to eat every 2 hours. So I had a little thermal bag with me, like a purse, and I had a cat carrier or, you know, a carrier. They went everywhere. They went into grocery stores. They went everywhere. They didn't sit in the car anywhere. I don't understand. People, this is a four-month-old puppy. It's a Boston Terrier. It's tiny. They could have gone. He could have taken the dog with him.
Mm-hmm. It's just, there's just so many mistakes. It's like, don't leave your pet outside. Do not adopt from a pet store. I'm glad they're reunited. And frankly, I just feel because it's a $10,000 reward. I mean, this teenager would not do an interview. And she said she just found it in a pet carrier, the pet carrier that belonged to the owners alongside of school. Something doesn't add up, but I don't know.
Happy
I mean, prom. I don't know about that story. I want to go to the next one. I don't know if you heard about this, where a guy wanted to commit suicide, and he went into a lion den at a zoo in Chile. He stripped naked, okay? It was his wish to be attacked and mauled to death, all right? And he had a suicide note in his clothes. And I don't know if you have the picture. So he went into this den, and then a lion and the lioness started, they actually played with him first, and then they mauled him, and they went for his head, the lion, and the lioness went for his pelvic area. And the zoo officials didn't have any fast-acting tranquilizer gun, so they shot them dead. Now, they did have some kind of tranquilizer, but they shot the guy instead of the lion and lioness. In the aftermath, those two lions were killed, and the man lived. He was in grave condition, but he, you know, the latest news came out today. He is going to recover now. I don't know. I mean, being in the pelvic area, the head, I mean, I don't know how serious these injuries are. And in the suicide note, he had some biblical references about Daniel and the lions, and that something about, you know, God will save him. Well, God did save him. If you believe in God, he was saved, and these lions lost their lives. And people are outraged at the zoo killed these lions. And the zoo official said, you know, they have to put a person before the animals, but they too are upset that they had to kill lions. Did these lions deserve to die?
No.
I mean, I could take a year to explain a person with severe depression who does want to die. There are those people that do. They don't want to be saved from jumping off the bridge or jumping in with the lions.
But he did this in front of people, in front of children, parents.
I know,
their,
and
the
naked, no
eyes.
Less, which
well,
is
it's just
is
like
traumatizing.
The idiots that want death by cop. It's this
or
is
jumping
death.
In front of another car or a truck.
Make somebody else responsible.
Responsible
for
because you're too afraid to do it. But why should the lions have to be dead?
I know. They had a private ceremony for both and funerals for the lion and the lioness.
Another idiot.
I mean, he's got
Pick
international
another way to do it.
Fame. He knew this would get notoriety.
Well, his name
it's like,
should
you're
not be
do
put
it.
Anywhere.
No,
and
it shouldn't. And now he probably has no
forever.
And brain damage.
I know. I mean, like I said, yeah.
And, and then the Chilean government is going to end up taking care of him for the rest of his life because he's stupid.
And these two animals lost their lives. I think that's so wrong. They said that this particular zoo, and I don't have the name of it, people have complained about it's not in the best condition. They have tigers in small cages. So maybe this will bring light to this zoo, and maybe people can help. Some people want to close down, but you're doing this in this manner. You know, I don't want anybody to kill themselves, but if you're going to commit suicide, I mean, do not do it in front
privately.
Of
privately.
Yeah.
Don't make someone else responsible. Just jumping off of medians in front of semi-trucks.
And don't make other living beings die.
Yeah, it's just...
And then you survive.
Yeah, a hole.
Yeah. Ooh. Well, and then there's a vet in Taiwan who actually did commit suicide.
Oh,
that
yeah.
is so sad.
It's really, really heartbreaking. This is a vet, and she was also the director of a shelter in Taiwan. And last year she did an interview. And in this interview, she was asking people to adopt and don't shop for pets, because in the shelter, she said she had to euthanize like 700 animals, basically dogs, in 2 years, because they give them 12 days there to find a home or to get back to their owners. And when they can't, they have to euthanize. And she said that on her first day as a director, she cried. Mm-hmm. We all know what that is like. You know, when you're around that in a shelter and you see animals die, we've all done it. I mean, we've all cried our eyes out. This is really, really hard to do. And this is a vet who really loved animals.
Day after day
so
after day.
In this interview, because she stated that 700 animals were euthanized in 2 years, there was such backlash that she was called the female butcher and the beautiful executioner. But they wanted her to die. And so she did it.
Animal rescue people
she did it, and she said she will die by the same drugs that she's used for the dogs. And she injected herself and she died 5 days later. I mean, what is going on here that this cyberbullying is so out of hand? That
well, these are also still the same people who refuse to volunteer at a shelter.
They want to tell
and
you
see
what
it's
to
like.
Do.
They want to tell you how to run the shelter, but they don't want to go in and do the dirty work and see animals coming in and coming
they,
in and coming
they don't
in, and
be
where
scooping
do you go?
Up the poop. They don't want to be cleaning up the vomit. They don't want to be. They don't want to do the day-to-day care and maintenance on the animals,
which is not glamorous.
And it's not a glamorous job. It's a very, very hard job.
Yeah.
The animals come in. They need care. Think about it. What does a cat or a dog do? They eat, sleep, and excrete. I mean, seriously. Mm-hmm.
People behind their computers, though, and it's really on the increase. The way people bully people, and they tell people to die. It's so disturbing to me. I mean, Janine, Hillside is a no-kill shelter, but do you hear any complaints at all from people?
I do. Now, we do have very rare exceptions. If an animal is extremely ill, we have no choice. Or if there's a lot of aggression there that the dog can't be around people because we have to take care of that animal. We have no choice. It's extremely rare. But we do have people, like you said, keyboard cowboys. They can sit there and they can say all kinds of things. You are not a no-kill shelter. No-kill doesn't mean never kill. There are times when you have to do that for the sake of the animal. If they are that sick, right now we have a dog, we have tried everything. He's a young boy. We've had him to several vets, and he was born with a lot of problems, and there is absolutely no help for him. And it's really sad for us to even think about it, but we have no choice. He's skin and bones. Nothing we do, no vet will be able to help him. We have to be humane in what we do also. So we take that into consideration, and still there's people who do have something to say about it. And it is, on our end, it is compassion fatigue.
Mm-hmm.
It truly is, because it's every single day there's another case, whether it's dogs or cats or birds or, you know, hoarding situations or, you know, animals that were hit by cars. And for us, seeing it all the time, just one little comment by somebody on their computer can really set things off. You just really, you don't know.
Because they have no idea what it feels like and what it's like to go and have to do all this. They have no clue. They just want to sit back and shoot their medicine.
I've never had to actually put the needles in or anything because I've never been trained in that. But I have been in the room with animals because I don't think anything should die alone.
That's my philosophy.
Okay, so I have gone in. I have also been there and helped and seen the anguish when they had to take a specific dog and have it put to sleep. It's not a fun thing. And the people that do it every day or the people that have it as part of their job really, really need to be commended and not. They don't do it by choice. That is nothing that somebody that works with animals wants to do. It's the worst of worst jobs in the kennels.
It's one of the hardest jobs ever. There is compassion fatigue along with it. And most people that work in shelters do suffer some form of depression. Mm-hmm. Many people are on antidepressants or they drink. And I can tell you this from the Animal Rescue League. I'm not going to name anyone. But the one woman who was the manager said that she's going to go to hell for what she's doing because it was her job to pick and choose. And that is so hard. I mean,
we both know somebody who's has had definitely had this affect her because she had to pick animals out. It has affected her whole life.
And it will. And mm-hmm. This is a vet. She didn't want to kill animals. And the problem I see here, people want to blame the shelters.
I know, without ever being in there or knowing what it's like.
But it's the owners. The owners are irresponsible.
I know, animals are there.
Right. Now, there are some bad shelters.
Yes.
And
bad
where they don't, they're not ethical. And, okay. And they do kill, and they don't actively search for homes. Oh. Now, I mean, that's not the majority of shelters, but they do exist, and they should be investigated or closed down. But it's the owners. You cannot be blaming the shelters for what people are not responsible
owners.
For. It's like, it's your pet, and because of you, for whatever reason, you abandon, surrender, you no longer have time for your dog, you give it up. And it's
I told you I had a lady bring a cat in because it didn't match her new sofa.
And did you hear that? I mean, I've heard that before.
That is the truth. And they come up with the stupidest ideas and reasons. There are no good reasons.
I know.
Unless you've had a stroke or a heart attack mm-hmm. and you're too ill to take care of it and you don't have any family that'll take care of it.
People have died and no family member wants that animal.
Wants to take the dog, and that's heartbreaking.
Purina used to have an agreement in order for old people to adopt. I don't know if they still do anymore, but they had a form and they would pay the adoption fee for an old person to get an animal. And on there, they had to give the name of a relative that promised that they would be responsible for this pet when this person passed. I think that was a wonderful thing. I think it should be that way for everybody.
I know.
And when you tell somebody to spay or neuter your pet, you've also got to tell them, because you're going to neuter that dog does not mean you yourself are being neutered.
Men feel like that.
They do.
Especially emasculated.
And here.
It's like, I'm not doing that to my dog.
Yeah, I don't want that done to me.
I think these people should spend a day at the shelter.
I think they should, in the room,
see what actually happens, what people are forced to do at a shelter. And, okay, we're down to 3 minutes.
I think they need to volunteer for a whole week.
I just
want
to get out.
These people that want to bash us.
Very, very quickly, I just want to mention this PetSmart groomer. Mm. He hasn't been brought up in charges yet, but an owner took their dog in, a dachshund, to be groomed. And 3 minutes after they took the dog in, the guy came out. The dog was bleeding from the mouth, couldn't breathe, and the dog died. There was a veterinarian on the premises, and they found out later, like I said, I mean, they did x-rays. He had the broken ribs and the punctured lung, and it's from the man because the dog had no issues prior to that. And I guess what I want to say, PetSmart, there is a history because I researched it. However, it's with any groomer, whether it's a corporate or small, check out your vet, check for references, because you're leaving your dog or cat in the hands of someone and you're not there. I mean, think about it, as a cherished family member, I mean, you just don't want to leave your dog with anyone.
When I came back here from Florida, I had a poodle, and I used to have her groomed all the time. I took her to a grooming place, and I'm not going to mention it, but I took her to a grooming place. I walked back in to pick her up, and the woman had another dog on the table, and she's smacking that dog around. I got my dog, I got out of there, and if you think I would ever go there, not.
That's what I mean.
Spread the word.
Yes, and the word got spread around. I'm terrible about that. I will do
word
that.
Word of mouth is great advertising.
Yeah, ask. Yes.
Good or bad.
Ask mm-hmm. around. I mm-hmm. mean, yes. Because you just can't leave your pet with just anyone.
Boarding facilities also.
Yes.
What's that?
Much better to use. What's the one you work for?
Dogvacay.com.
Can we say something about the Animal Rescue League, really?
Yes, I just want to say this really quickly. Mary wants to say something about some cats that were found. And I just want to say there's a dog named Ollie who, after he went on a trip with his family, he became listless, didn't want to eat, and eventually became paralyzed. And there's nothing to be done. They ran tests and everything. They went multiple times to the vet. And in the end, he's ready to be euthanized. An assistant was holding the dog to comfort him and found something, and it was actually a tick. And it was the tick that caused the paralysis, and the dog is now fine. He recovered in 10 hours, believe it or not, but he's that close. Watch out for ticks.
Yep.
So,
I mean,
check your animal. Now, I'm going to let Mary have the floor right here. Some cats were found in Center Township yesterday.
Woman, I don't know when, but I saw it on Facebook, it was yesterday. A woman dropped off a whole bunch of cats.
32. And kittens.
Lots of kittens. And
Tell us what they need.
The Animal Rescue League needs cat litter, cat food, kitten food, foster parents, anything you can do to help, because they over 280 or 300 cats there right now.
I think right now it's kitten season everywhere, and I bet Hillside can use a lot of help too.
Yeah.
With everything? With cats?
Everything.
I think every shelter needs the same at this point.
But right now, yeah, there is a big need because there is a glut of kittens. If you can foster, do it.
Okay, so the ARL, and I think they're, berksarl.org, and what's their phone number? 373?
I have to look it up.
610-373-8830.
There you go. So I want to thank my guest tonight, always opinionated, and I always enjoy this show so much. Pam, Janina, and Mary, thank you guys so much for joining me this
evening.
Thank you
for
having
us.
And that's it for tonight. Have a nice, safe Memorial Day. Good night.